Hi, welcome back to the dBs Institute YouTube channel. I'm DC Breaks, and in this video, I'm going to be looking at designing kick drums in Kilohearts Phase Plant. So the first thing I want to do when designing a kick is to determine its fundamental frequency, or its main tone, if you like, the pitch of the drum. And so I'm going to start by designing an analog layer, which was going to be a sine wave tone. And because I don't want this to correspond to the notes of the keyboard, I'm going to turn the harmonic down and then choose the pitch by using the shift control. So let's put that to 60 hertz. And then you can see I have a flat 60 hertz tone, depending, regardless of what note I play on my keyboard. You'll see I've got a 4-4 pattern here. And if I play that, then we just have a 60 hertz tone in a 4-4 pattern. Okay, now the tone of the drum, or the pitch of the drum, isn't actually completely continuous normally. So when the beater that is triggered by the kick pedal hits the skin of the drum, there's actually a change in pitch usually, and this can make our drum sound more realistic. So to simulate this or synthesize this, I'm going to use an envelope. I'm going to remove the sustain phase, have a fairly short decay time. We can play around with this to kind of shape our drum correspondingly. And then I'm just going to route this to the shift. Now the amounts that we're talking about here are pretty fine. So I'm going to be bringing the amount of the envelope that's being sent to the shift right down, and I'm going to hit play and then just tweak it so it starts to sound a bit more kind of natural. So if it's up there, it sounds artificial. The next thing I might want to do is to control the sustain of the kick drum. At the moment, it's just being controlled by how long my MIDI notes are, but we might sort of choose to control that by bringing the sustain down generally and then controlling the decay time. So if we want a very short kick drum, around 200 milliseconds sounds okay to start with. And at the moment we have the attack very short, but the next thing we're going to do is add a transient. So that's the change in sound level, if you like, from nothing when there's no kick drum being hit to the very first onset of sound. And because that's the beater hitting the skin of the kick drum, it tends to be a full frequency, a lot of energy type of sound. And this main tone doesn't actually develop until a little after that. So we're just going to back off the attack. We'll try 20 milliseconds to start with. And you'll hear how that kind of softens the sound a little. So I'm now going to segue a little bit into showing you how to design a transient, that initial impact on the kick drum. So let's just save this kick demo. And we're going to turn off this instance of Phaseplant. Phaseplant is quite CPU intensive, so it's a good idea to kind of minimize that when you're working in Phaseplant. And we're going to look at this preset that I've previously designed here, which I call my random transient designer. So don't worry about any of the modulation at the moment. All of these are doing is generating random values for my macros. Let's look at how the transient is designed, and then we'll look at how this is a useful process for designing transients for your kick drum. So the sound is being generated by a noise generator. This is set to this one here, which is a tuned noise. So this is noise that has noise, but it also has harmonic content, which means that you can pitch it. So once again, I've removed the keyboard element, if you like, the harmonic content, and using shift instead. This is being controlled by this macro here. So depending on how what this is on, we can get a different pitch to our noise. This is then being run through some saturation, and the drive of the saturation is being controlled by this macro here. We're then running through a filter, which is just doing quite a broad sweep bell boost, a bit like an EQ, if you like. And the cutoff frequency, or the center frequency of this, is being controlled by this macro up here that I've called tone. So as you see, as I move it around, it sweeps through the frequency spectrum. Then we have another filter, which is a high pass filter. And again, the cutoff is being controlled by, you guessed it, this macro up here, the filter. And then we have our envelope. And you'll see at the moment it's incredibly short, almost no attack, and there's actually no decay at the moment, but the length of this can be controlled by this macro here. So if I hit play, you'll hear how the length can be changed using this macro. Now you'll see all of these other parameters are changing randomly. That's because these random values are being sent to these macros, and that's going to allow us to generate lots and lots of different transients that we can try out in our main kick preset. So to turn this off, you can just bring the mod wheel up. This is being routed to the output amount of our random generator here. So at the moment, this is now going to stay the same. And we can see how these different parameters affect it. So we've got some multiband distortion. That's some processing on lane two. It's just a preset. But the mix of that has been controlled by this macro here. We have the attack, which is being controlling the transient shaper attack level over here. And we've got pitch. We've also got a disperser, so that's controlling the amount of the disperser here, and that adds a kind of zappy quality to it. It can sound a little artificial, but for certain genres like techno, that might be desirable. We've seen the tone is controlling this EQ effectively, so we can have it brighter or duller or lower. We've got saturation again here and the filter. So the way that this modulation works up for each of these macros, we have a random value being generated by our random modulation generator here. This is controlling or is equaling a value from the sample and hold. So this spits out a value. The sample and hold then samples whatever value it is at any given time when it's triggered. In other words, when a note is pressed, and then this is being sent to in this case, the length, and then each kind of one of these pairs, if you like, is controlling. So we're getting a different random amount for each of our macros. And what that means is that we can come to our audio channel here. I've already set it up to record. I can loop this. Let's just get out of our cycle here. Oops. Hit record, and then we're going to be generating lots of random different transients. Okay, that should do it. So now all we have to do is come down to functions, remove the silence, export all of our transients. I've already got that ready to go. And now if we come back, I'm just going to turn off Phase Plant here, come back to our kick demo. So now we can come in and insert a sampler. We can load up the transients that we've just produced. And if we play these together now, you'll start to hear that the kick drum, whereas it sounded just like a pure tone before, or slightly pure tone, if it would help if I turn Phase Plant back on. Now it starts to sound a bit more like a realistic kick. Now again, we don't want this to have any harmonic content, so let's just give this some pitch. And the beauty of this is that we can now flick through our different transients, and it's amazing how much character the transient gives to the kick drum overall. So when we find one that we like, quite like that transient number two, we can then start to process these things together. So typically this might involve running through some saturation to kind of fatten things up a little bit. So if we just come down to distortion, we can choose saturation like so. And again, what I would normally look to do here is to control some of these amounts using macros. Something else that we might like to put, which I normally put on lane three, would be a transient shaper. So we can again kind of control that initial punch, but of both things together now. You'll notice I haven't really controlled the length or the shape of this because it's so short. We don't really need to worry about that. It's a good idea to probably run everything through a limiter. We might also want to add in a little bit of reverb, depending on whether you're trying to create something that's completely sort of artificial or sounds a little bit more realistic, if it's in a room, if it's a bit more live sounding. Probably a very short size. Again, very fine margins to make that sound realistic. And so we can go on adding different kinds of processing like that. But now we have something that approximates a fairly realistic sounding kick drum. Hey guys, I hope you're enjoying the content. Just to let you know that we offer online courses in a range of creative subjects. So if you're interested in taking your skills and knowledge to the next level, check out the link below. Now, another option is to also add in a third layer, which, depending on what vibe you're going for, could be another sample. So in this case, I'm going to try and find a live sounding kick. Okay, so I've brought in a live sounding kick. If I just get rid of the other two layers. And bear in mind, this is running through all the same processing. What I'd normally look to do here though is, because it's really only the kind of character that I want, I don't really want any of the tone. So I'm going to use a filter, a high pass filter, and just sweep it up to remove a lot of the body and sort of low end of the kick. It would help if I put it before the envelope. So it's that kind of, those frequencies there that we want to get rid of. And that can just help to make things sound a little bit more realistic and a bit more lifelike. Again, we're probably going to want to set the pitch of this ourselves. Could bring this up. So without. Sounds a bit flat, a bit lifeless, a bit artificial. Now, because that really is just kind of noise, really, we could also synthesize that ourselves. So let's have a look at that workflow. So we just generate some noise. Again, probably harmonic noise because that's kind of what this is. But we're just gonna, again, add a filter to remove the low end so that we're not muddying things up. It's important to kind of try and keep things clean. So again, we're going to let our tone here do all the heavy lifting in terms of the low end of the kick, and we're just going to be looking to add a little bit of character on top. Okay, it doesn't sound great at the moment, so let's, again, we need to get rid of our harmonic here and control the pitch manually. Now, this is probably going to be something more like way up here. Need to bring the gain down quite a lot. Again, we don't want that attack in there. Let's bring the cutoff up. Let's try bringing this up a bit further. You can make this a bit stereo as well. And then just reduce the sustain down and control this layer, if you like, with the decay. Benefit perhaps from a little bit of distortion just to kind of fatten it up a bit. And actually, I don't really like the top end either, so I'm just going to use a low pass filter to take off some of the top end. So without, and then with. So that's another workflow. In this case, I kind of prefer the character of the live one. It just sounds a bit more realistic. Might be that I need to take the transient off a little bit as well to kind of allow our transient to provide the transient. So depending on the approach that you're going for, it may be that you're trying to create something that sounds really realistic and live sounding. It may be that you want to go for something more artificial. So again, a huge amount of flexibility in Phase Plant to add different types of processing. The disperser, as we saw earlier, is great for making that kind of zappy techno style kicks. So we can control the amount with a macro. Let's do this to show you another example. a bit more realistic. And slightly more synthetic. But generally, the approach, no matter what you're kind of aiming to do, you need to have a kind of pure tone or a fundamental pitch of the kick drum, which tends to be a sine wave. A transient, as we've seen, my workflow is to design these separately and add these in as samples, and then potentially layering some kind of tuned noise or perhaps another sample, making sure to clean up that low end so that it doesn't clash with the low end that we've previously designed. But otherwise, that's my workflow for working with kicks in Phase Plant. So I hope you enjoyed that video. Let me know what you think in the comments below. Don't forget to subscribe to the dBs YouTube channel to get more great videos like this delivered straight to your inbox. And I'll see you in the next one.